Cornetta, everybody.
What I was saying, and everybody just please agree with me even if you don't, is that the best part of XOXO is just watching Andy be exasperated. It's the, come on.
Can I, is it weird if I do your introduction while you're standing
good. I gotta get water anyway.
Oh, so. Right. Again, one more time for Mike Cornetta.
Let's high five. So I know that you're all really nervous, and that even though this room is freezing, you're already sweating. We're gonna take a quick moment here so that everybody can just take a deep breath and calm the crap down. I also have a little bit of a dilemma, which is that I promised myself I would not Instagram from up here, but I do really want to send a picture of this to my parents. Oh, if you wanna give the thumbs up, that's gonna make my day. Oh. My God, this is the coolest thing I have ever done. All right. You guys are the best. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, hello. My name is Mike Rignetta. I write and host a YouTube show called Idea Channel. It is about popular culture, critical theory, and technology, and I'm also one third of a live lecture-based performance art trio called Meme Factory. Maybe you've heard about it 30 seconds before just now. If you know what either of those things are, I would love to high-five you at some point during the conference if we haven't already. Thank you very much. A little too quickly for the thing sometimes. I want to thank Andy for inviting me. It is a huge thrill to share this space with you guys. Some of you are nothing short of internet heroes, and here I wish that I had pulled one of Christina's slides, but too late. Without your shoulders to stand on, nothing that I do would exist. I never would have thought it would be possible to make a living speaking quickly about and on the internet. So it is a huge honor to stand up here and wax presentational at a group of such distinguished pillars of internet, cultural monoliths, hackers. I'm sorry to everyone except Fred Benenson, who I know this is his dream in life too. Is Fred here? Did I just make it? All right. Jammers and actually sorry this time, disruptors. I tried to get the most metal, yeah. And this is what I want to talk about. Not about how much I love you guys, which I do, but rather how the successes of others can give someone permission to be themselves. My little presentation here is going to be sort of different, kind of like Christina's. I'm not going to really talk about making things. I'm not going to talk about my origin story. I'm actually going to talk about everybody's origin story, hopefully, because what I'm going to be talking about is how you make yourself and how that process, how it might relate to that seven, but really four-letter word that we have all come to know and love, especially since Andy made fun of it, like getting up on stage the first thing and then made it verboten for anybody to say it. So we've heard and will continue to hear the internet and all of its related technologies described as D-word technologies, which is maybe a little unfair because this suggests that the internet has come along and it has caused trouble, and that it has interrupted. It's like a Polaroid. It takes a second to develop. That it's interrupted the natural and just order of things and has thrust upon the world its own agenda where previously nothing was the matter. It does, though, properly capture the like spirit, attitude, or position held by one side of the resultant rift in the status quo. It evokes a kind of upset. And I think it's fair to say that many people, because of the internet, are upset. Some of them are upset because of the likelihood of encountering spoilers has effectively skyrocketed, and many other people are upset about the internet because practically it provides a great many economic shortcuts. So if disruption is the $1 million word, then the $2 million word is disintermediation, right? And talk surrounding disintermediation also has a certain tenor to it. It suggests that there was infrastructure which was built and existed, and now the internet is tearing it down, unbuilding it, or at the very least supporting its dereliction and eventual implosion. It describes a kind of deconstructive internet. It's not bad. For the most part, it's not destructive, it is deconstructive. You know, like, sometimes you have to get out with the old to make way for the new, but I'm not so sure that this is the whole story. I think that there is another internet, which is to say, it is the same internet, just different parts of it, and maybe even the same parts, but viewed a little differently. And I'd like to call that internet the constructive internet. So the constructive internet, it connects locales not unreachable because of tolls or roadblocks, but because there were no roads. The constructive internet is not a wrecking ball, not sorry. Just gonna make you look at that for a little while. It's a pathway. It's not a sawzall. It's a flag in the sand. The difference between the deconstructive and the constructive internet is the difference between a shortcut and a desire path. A shortcut is, strictly speaking, a less traveled, faster route. But a desire path is a user group built rethinking of what routes should exist but don't. If the worldwide media ecosystem is the park and the dominant modes of business and communication are the landscape architect-approved and Department of Parks and Recreation installed pathways, then the deconstructive internet is knowing that it's faster to get to the food trucks if you just go through the woody part where all of the couples are making out, and the constructive internet is that weird strip of worn-down grass where you might hesitate for a moment to walk down it because it's clearly not supposed to be there. But wait, who more than you, the person walking through the park, gets to decide where you get to walk? And clearly, there are a bunch of other people who feel the same way that you do. So practically, the constructive internet is many things. IFTTT, Seamless, Evernote, and the countless animated GIF reaction albums on Imgur are new routes that were not available or even considered pre-internet. Most significantly and importantly, I think, the constructive internet is communities. 6 seasons in a movie? 4 seasons in a movie? Yeah. So connections created between people who before now would never, only with significant effort, have crossed paths. Some of them are ad hoc. On the small, large, temporary, permanent matrix, here are the communities which develop around the funny hash or Tumblr tag, and communities which subscribe to a blog feed or comment on a post. Many of these communities, though, are large and permanent. Here is the fandom. Now, before we get too much further, let me totally and completely acquiesce to the fact that fandom has existed for a very long time before the internet. I would argue, though, that the para-internet fandom is a totally new sense of fandom. It is not a geographically far-flung group of people who point their faces in the same direction towards the movie screen, book, or television show with a shared regularity, but rather a fully networked group of creatively involved fans constantly working and celebrating alongside one another. Fandoms no longer meet exclusively at the book release, the yearly con, or the regular local meetup at the Panda Express, not talking from experience. In other words, fandom has reached a kind of cultural prevalence it has not previously enjoyed, especially not under the name fandom. I mean, like Shakespeare and Leech certainly had fandoms, but today fandoms are countless, and they are far flung. There is the Sherlock fandom, the Doctor Who fandom, the My Little Pony fandom, Homestuck, Arrested Development, Welcome to Night Vale, Harry Potter, Breaking Bad, Nerdfighters, Game of Thrones, Star Wars, Torchwood, The Walking Dead, Avatar, and heck, there are even some people claiming to be in my fandom, for whom I am very grateful and by which I am incredibly flattered. As a side note, the list of fandoms tag on Tumblr is incredibly interesting. So if the internet ever has its own art of war, except art of the internet and not about war, but about being a smart and respectful internet user, shout out to Jay Smooth. Something my good friend Kenyatta Cheese said should go in there. He said that fandoms are not about fans gathering around the media they love, but about gathering around each other near the media they love. The deconstructive internet, right, allows fans access to the media and personalities that they are absolutely bonkers over. The constructive internet allows fans access to each other. The theory, actually, is that the most successful, which I realize is a wily concept in and of itself, so bear with me here, the most successful fandoms don't have the best media or best top-down access provided to that media, but rather the best interpersonal relationships, the best stories, the most engaging, ongoing conversations. So things like DeviantArt, Twitter, Tumblr, Steam, Reddit, LiveJournal, and forums upon forums upon forums allow fans to create and share art, fan fictions, GIFs, remixes, parodies. They develop fan theories and headcanon, theorize ships, and generally relate to one another as much, if not more, then directly to the media that has caused them to gather in the first place. I could watch this animated GIF for the rest of my life. I don't know this guy's name, his real name. I think it's Jacob, but you can find him on Flickr. I think his photos are CC licensed. His Joker is, it's mind-blowing. It's mind-blowing. So anyways. The weird thing that this seems to suggest, and you would be right thinking that it is both weird and merely suggested, is that the canon media, the TV show, the book, the video game, the YouTube show, the whatever, isn't really the most important part of the fan community. Rather, it's the bond between and excitement of the people in that community. This guy's Deadpool is also the best. It's certainly inspired by that media, but by no means part and parcel with it. And that is what allows that community's persistence. The hypothesis then is that maybe there could, and given the infinite alternate universe's size of the internet, certainly there must be a fandom without canonical media. It would subsist primarily instead on the attitude and interpersonal connections of the fans involved and not a perfectly pervasive devotion to one particular spectacle. As my close friend and Meme Factory amigo Patrick Davison points out in the forthcoming Meme Factory book, hopefully it will be out before the world turns to dust, there is, and that fandom is, no laughing please, furries. You guys did a really good job. The furry fandom does not have one piece of canonical media around which the community gathers. It is a set of media, like Black Sad, Lackadaisy, and even The Lion King. And they have different significance and different meanings for different furs. And what's more, not every creator contributing to that set of furry media self-identifies as a fur or set out to even create furry media. There is even debate within the community about what actually qualifies as fur media or furdom itself. The furry fandom is not organized by one particular piece of media or even canonical definition of what a furry is. It is at once singular and diasporadic. In a sense, it is more remote, more far-flung, more fluid than a standard fandom. And as such, the internet and furries are a match made in heaven. Did the internet create furries then? Well, no. There were plenty of furries pre-internet, and they did just fine. This was some really deep Google right here. I had to fire up Tor to get this demotivator. There are, however, more furries now than before the internet. So, is it fair to say then that the internet has created some furries? I think so, yes. I've spoken to a couple furs and they think so as well. And I think that this is significant and it relates eventually to our broader point about the weird and different kind of disintermediation and being given permission to be yourself. Because imagine you're a teenager, or really imagine you're yourself and you're sitting at home in your bedroom, tortured and lamenting, I am the only person in the world who is fascinated with anthropomorphic depictions of bears or cats. That seems a ridiculous thing to think now, doesn't it? Of course you're not the only one. Furries exist. And for at least one, though likely many more people, the discovery of the furry fandom and their ability to connect with it, the fact that they happened down the furry desire path, if you will allow me such an unfortunately suggestive phrase, was of significant personal importance. This disintermediation is not really media or brands or access to celebrities. It's not the news or video content or access to scholarly knowledge. Alongside all of these things, which yes, the internet has game changed, the internet has also changed the way people can construct themselves. It has provided access to knowledge and communities and media and people who can help unball the complex knot of self-constitution. I mean, the self is a very complicated thing because it isn't accessed directly. The reason you have to spend lots of long nights staring out the window, looking at the moon, visiting all of the coffee shops, and smoking all of the cigarettes in an effort to figure out who you are and what you believe and what you desire is because you can't just shut your eyes and observe how you feel. The self is a little bit like a pitch dark room. If you want to find the sofa, you have to go feeling around for it. Maybe it's right in front of you, maybe it's not. If you want to know how you feel about the conflict in Syria, maybe you immediately know, or maybe you have to consider it for a while. The philosopher Immanuel Kant described the systematic elusiveness of the I. And he wasn't talking about knowing if you're a furry or not, but he was talking about the apprehension of the self and how it's always kind of retreating. For some, certainly more than others, and for many very different reasons. A common difficulty, I think, it's fair to say, is the preoccupation with knowing what is acceptable or even possible to want or do. The self retreats not just as an effect of its complexity, but sometimes as an effect of its inevitable comparison to other selves. It's difficult to confidently construct oneself without placing it alongside others. The true self, if there is even one, can retreat behind cultural norms, community practices, social and societal expectations. So that puts us in this weird spot, right? And not like the dog park in Welcome to Night Vale weird, but metaphysically weird. Don't think about the dog park. You want to be true to yourself, but you might not know what options are available for inclusion in that truth unless you go shopping, I guess, is one way to put it. But are they true if they came from somewhere outside of your own brain? And this is actually a big, important question. Is there a truly and totally internal self? Or put another way, would everyone who currently self-identifies as goth or pro-life or Democrat or an Evanescence fan, or who identifies as a furry, have come to that conclusion independent of the actions or preferences of others? I don't have an answer, because one doesn't exist. But here's what I think. The self is understood only through its properties. You only know what you think and believe based upon your experiences, which are themselves an inscrutable stew of nature, nurture, environment, action, reaction, expectation, rebellion, and probably also a fair amount of luck and entropy. Asking whether someone is truly this or truly that is ultimately unhelpful and honestly just brings me right back to the McCarthy-era-esque poser witch hunt of the 1990s. More so than whether someone is this or that, I think it's important to ask if someone feels comfortable identifying as this or that. Part and parcel with that comfort in self-discovery is seeing and recognizing in others, in people, in communities, and around the world, that which you feel stirring in yourself. And since we're talking about the internet, it's easy to connect this line of thinking to those thought of as having a special home online, thought of as existing because of or with reliance on the internet. Communities like furries or demisexuals, who have been a recent and frequent topic of Tumblr's social justice community. Demisexuals do not experience sexual attraction based on looks or personality, but rather only once they've formed a strong romantic bond with a partner. Or otherkin, a community of people self-identifying as partially or entirely non-human, part spirit, part mythical being, life form from another dimension, normally inanimate object or animal slash cartoon character, positioning them rather, though not entirely, in line with furries. According to Wikipedia, otherkin have had a persistent online presence since about 1990. Eventually, though, we'll be talking not just about the people who seem to only have a home because of the internet, but about everyone for whom internet and self are somehow related. That number is only going to get bigger, always. And I would guess that it's represented with abnormal distinction in this room right now. I mean, that's why we're here, right? Whether it's for art, business, media, or technology, the internet is the tool which helped us peel away all of those layers to get to that inside thing. But you know, it's not a special club, and that peeling away process works just as well for people who consume as it does for people who make, because the more and more different media you are exposed to as an effect of the great disintermediation, and the more and more different people you encounter because of those desire paths, the more accurate and complete and fine-grained and detailed and complex and confusing and exciting your conception of the world is. And as follows, the more you know that no matter who you are, yourself is worth celebrating. It's most notable and visible for me, I'm gonna just touch my mic a whole lot. It's most notable and visible for me, at least, in the young, queer, and fluidly gendered communities finding each other and media which speaks to them online. A very recent pillar of that media has been the podcast Welcome to Night Vale. So, whose main character, radio host Cecil, has a romantic relationship with the town scientist Carlos. And amidst the pages and pages and pages of fan art, most common are romantic depictions of Cecil and Carlos. It's probably also worth mentioning that Welcome to Night Vale has been hovering like a glow cloud around the number one podcast in America spot for quite a while. Are these things related? I'm not sure, but it's certainly a big deal. In writing about Night Vale for Policy, Mike, Zainab Akande points out just how big a deal. She wrote that it is these two characters that make Welcome to Night Vale so central in giving media representations status quo of white and heteronormative a run for its money. Why does this matter? Because media representation matters. Why does media representation matter? Because the media is a pretty central force and plays a vital role in society at large. Mass media in particular has the power to change or reinforce the habits of its consumers. It also aids in constructing worldviews of its consumers by reproducing reality to an extent. Perception is the name of the game, and it's difficult to perceive what is non-existent, or in the case of persons of color and LGBTQ characters, severely lacking compared to the real-world diversity scale. Night Vale's universe features floating cats, mountain deniers, clocks that aren't real, hooded figures, a taco place with a forsaken menu, and a woman without a face who lives in your house. Yes, your house. She also lit your refrigerator on fire, and you're pretty mad about it. You'll get there. In the world of the show, Cecil and Carlos's relationship is just about the most normal and traditional thing going on. One particular reading of Night Vale shows how we, like people in the real world, pay absolutely no mind at all to all kinds of absurd nonsense, and yet homosexual relationships remain a thing to focus on, to treat as separate from the norm. As such, I can't help but make at least a passing comparison to that one Lonely Island video about spring break. To say that this indicates something of a sea change... sorry. Might be prematurely optimistic, but Welcome to Night Vale is in great internet-only company. Orange is the New Black features a cast of not only primarily women, but in many incredibly complex women of color and one transgendered actress cast as her own gender. Laverne Cox's Sophia Bursett accomplishes much of what Akande attributes to Cecil and Carlos, a challenge to major market white heteronormativity with the added challenges to male cisgendered norms. Cox's portrayal of Bursett, charming, complicated, motivated, flawed, has earned her a huge following and has given the trans community a voice in a piece of nearly major market media. So maybe this is a little bit internet utopian, but I'm gonna allow myself this pie in the sky dream that as the internet and access to media and access to distribution and audiences for that media continues to grow, so too will challenges to the idea of normal. The internet is not a system beholden, at least not in the way most broadcast is, and certainly not solely to the dominant attitudes about culture and by extension self-identification. And it's not some place that exists opposite, instead of, or in subjugation to real life. The internet is real life, and it is changing the way that people are living their real lives and the ways that they are being themselves. It's kind of like what Andy described at the beginning of the conference. At the heart of all these buzzwords, the fun and sometimes overplayed ways to talk about how we're changing the world and upsetting the status quo and going into the board meetings and flipping over all the tables is really that simple but complicated, and isn't that the beauty of it? Search for independence. And I think we've all learned counterintuitively, and like what Christina said, you sort of need a community to be independent. And that's what we're building. We're building this community of independent people, forging out completely alone, all together, doing our thing, and showing other people that it can be done. And that works for products and services and websites and media, yes, but it also works for social and cultural communities. And I think this is the greatest that we can ever hope for. Not that travel sites and publishing and manufacturing and distribution and whatever else didn't need to change, but there is something about people finding each other and in that process finding themselves that feels primary. To have not only routed around barriers stopping the distribution of media, but also to have built pathways between people consuming that media so they can find and identify with and celebrate one another and themselves, all of course while backing Hyperlight Drifter and paying Chelsea Wolfe directly for her newest record, I think that is pretty neat. Thank you.
Mike Renetta!